It's 1706 GMT. This is Focus on Africa from the BBC World Service. I'm Audrey Brown.
Focus on Africa at 60.
Coming up, we are into the 90s in our week-long celebration of Focus's 60th birthday. Recognize this reporter?
As Nelson Mandela turned around to go back inside, I put my hand out and he shook it and he said, "Oh, how very nice to see you again. Where have you been?"
Well, you know where she's been. I'll let you in on the secret later, though. But we're going to start in Malawi, where the High Court in Lilongwe has ruled that the Malawi police has to compensate 18 women and girls who were raped or sexually assaulted by police officers in October last year. A police operation took place while Peter Mutharika was president during the dramatic fallout of his disputed re-election, which was eventually overturned. A policeman was killed during anti-government protests, and the police are accused of exacting revenge on the people in the area. Tadala Chimkwezule is the president of the Women Lawyers Association of Malawi, who brought the case, and she joins us now on the line. Good evening to you, Ms. Chimkwezule. What is the size of the compensation? Good evening. Welcome to Focus. What is the size of the compensation that the 18 women and girls are going to get?
Right now, we don't have the actual size or the amount. However, there will be assessment within 21 days from today. So that will determine how much each of the girls, who are three girls and the 15 women, will get for compensation. So that is yet to be assessed.
What have the women said about this victory, in a sense, for them, for what had been done to them?
Definitely they're excited and happy because this has taken over 10 months to be heard. So it's not an easy thing. It's something that is quite a delight to them. So we cannot undermine the effect of this judgment. They are extremely happy.
Did the police try to defend the case for compensation?
Well, the compensation part, they did, in a way, at first, to some extent. However, the court has found that despite the fact that the investigations were not fully conducted, they still have to compensate the women for the wrong that they went through. The reason is there's a report by the Malawi Human Rights Commission, which actually acknowledges that the sexual assault against these women and girls was actually done. So that entails that they should be compensated at this moment in time.
And will they be facing criminal charges as well?
Yes, the court has ruled that within the next 30 days, the police should provide a report to the court, and in the report they should explain the arrests and the investigations that they have undertaken.
I understand that the court has also made a significant order on how the police must be held accountable in future. What does it say about that?
Essentially, I think one of the key things that has been acknowledged by the court is the establishment of the Independent Police Complaints Commission. So there is a law, the Police Act, which was enacted in 2010, which actually provided for the IPCC to be established. It is only up until we started the litigation in court, that's when an advert was put in the newspapers of Malawi by Parliament. So essentially what this entails going forward, if the duty bearers, who are the police, do any injustices to any Malawian, then they'll be held accountable through the IPCC, which is being established as we speak.
It must give you great satisfaction as a lawyer to see this happen. Is it unusual that the police are held to account in this way?
Yes, it's great satisfaction as a lawyer and as a president for Women Lawyers. I think it's a great achievement. We had several lawyers undertaking the case, Mrs. Yuda Soko and Wes Malonda, who were quite key. And then this case is quite a landmark because it's not every day that you have such a case where the police are held accountable. And we've already had colleagues in different countries, in Nigeria, in South Africa, asking us about this case in Kenya.
Okay.
So the effect of this case will not only be in Malawi.
Thank you so much, Tadala Chimkwezule, President of the Women Lawyers Association of Malawi. Now, Sam Okyere is one of the few media personalities, black that is, in South Korea. He's known as an actor, but also for his work to bridge the gap between people of his adopted country and Africans in general. But he recently found himself in the full glare of social media scrutiny when he criticized a group of Korean students who had painted their faces black while performing a parody of the dancing pallbearers from Ghana at a school graduation event. We spoke about reaction to his criticism, but also about life in general for him and other black people in South Korea.
When I first got here, there weren't too many foreigners here, but that number has grown tremendously over the past couple of years. I think we're pushing towards 3 million foreigners now in South Korea. When I was in school, I was pretty much the only black person on campus or in my entire department to have been so many people, so many Africans coming out here to study and whatnot. So the number has definitely grown steadily over the last couple of years. So if you're here, you're going to meet people from Liberia, Ghana, Rwanda, just from different parts of the continent.
So what's the experience like then being black in South Korea?
To be honest, it's the reason why I decided to go into the entertainment industry. I realized that there wasn't really a lot of representation. A lot of Africans did not really know about Korea, and a lot of Koreans did not really have an opportunity to get to know, for example, Africans and, you know, the different cultures that are there. So I decided to put myself in a position where I can expose a lot of Koreans to people like me and where we're from and our cultures, and vice versa, just tell other Ghanaians or other Africans about the Korean culture, the language and whatnot.
So what are the attitudes that Korean people hold towards black people?
I think for the most part, it's a thing of, like I said, lack of exposure, right? Where they haven't really had a lot of opportunity to meet so many different people. For example, if you look at Africa as a continent, right, there's so many countries, but you don't really have somebody that's teaching them that variety. So it's easy for, you know, a Korean who has not been exposed to subjects like that to just accept what they have probably seen on television. Because when I ask my Korean friends, what informs your identity or your image of a black person, they say the only opportunity we have to meet black people is through movies and dramas or whatever. So the portrayal of that is what they eventually get to understand is what the image of a black person is. For example, back in the day, people would not sit next to you on the subway because they're a bit afraid or they don't know what to say to you. There wasn't that opportunity to meet so many people. So there have been those experiences where some people will try to avoid you because they're afraid of you just because of what they've seen on TV. But there have been certain instances where people have just blatantly been sort of like racist. But that is pretty much everywhere you go. I don't think it's only peculiar to South Korea.
So when you saw a group of high school students doing basically blackface, the parody of the famous Ghanaian dancing pallbearer scene at the school graduation event, you called it out. But there was massive reaction to that. Tell me, what was the predominant reaction?
I think a lot of people, they misunderstood what was going on, because a lot of people thought the intent was to call out the kids and bash them or whatever, but that was not the intent at all, because I actually understand where the kids were coming from. They didn't mean to cause any harm. They thought, okay, we're doing a parody, we might as well do it in detail, right? So it was coming from a very misinformed place, but not a place of blatantly wanting to mock, you know, black people. So when it started out, it was a lot of meaningful conversations back and forth between some Koreans and I, who were trying to understand where I was coming from. And we had great conversations, but everywhere you go, you find out that there's a small group of people who don't have any intention of really continuing a conversation, a dialogue, which is the ultimate goal, but just want to attack. And we know that negativity is louder and people gravitate towards that. So that became a sort of controversy.
Do you think that in South Korea, people understand that it is insulting?
I feel like people, because they did not know the history behind blackface and why it's offensive, people didn't really understand or grasp that concept of, oh, but it was just a parody. Why would you be worked out? But some Koreans were able to make the connection, because this is not the first time I've made a statement about that. And truth be told, if I felt that way, I wouldn't be having this interview with you.
People actually also rounded on you and said that you yourself were racist also because of your past behavior on air. People quoted you making a gesture, like pulling your eyes with your fingers, which is a common, you know, gesture of racism against Asian people. And apparently you did this in something called Nan Summit in 2015.
The context was, we're talking about Ugly Faces Festival in Spain, and we're trying to do ugly faces. So there was no intent of mocking Koreans or Asians. Like, that wouldn't make any sense because I work and live in Korea. A lot of people knew that was from a good place, because if it was a bad place, they would have called me out on it. Now, when you look at it in terms of it being a sensitive issue, you say, hey, okay, that looks racist. I say, yeah, you're right. I didn't mean that, but I see why you could see it like that. So what do? You apologize.
And that's Sam Okere in South Korea. In a moment, a roundup of stories making news elsewhere on the continent. But first, with the latest sports headlines, Nishad Lada.
Hi Audrey, the European Champions League quarterfinals continue tonight with RB Leipzig playing Atletico Madrid. But the match will have to go some way to matching the drama of last night when Cameroon's Erik-Maxim Choupo-Moting scored a last-gasp winner against Atalanta to take Paris Saint-Germain through to the semis. Now, Choupo-Moting has described it as a special story. We'll hear from him later. We'll also hear from Kenya's World 1500 metres champion Tim Cheruiyot, who's among a host of African athletes who'll be returning to competitive action on Friday at the Monaco Diamond League meeting. Plus, there's another Serena versus Venus contest tonight. It's taking place at the Women's Tennis Tour event in Kentucky, where there's also been more African success. I'll tell you all about that in the sport in around 25 minutes from now.
Thank you very much, Nishad Lada. And now, with a roundup of stories making news elsewhere, as promised, Paul Bachibinga.
Thanks, Audrey. The Mozambican army is fighting to regain control of a key northern port, Mocimboa da Praia, seized earlier this week by Islamist militants. The military is reported to have suffered heavy losses, with dozens of soldiers killed and a patrol boat sunk. Reports say the army had to retreat after it ran out of ammunition. Nearly 60 jihadists are said to have died. In neighboring Malawi, a local civil society organization is taking President Lazarus Chakwera to task for violating his own government's anti-COVID-19 measures. He attended a funeral of a party stalwart in Blantyre yesterday. From Lilongwe, Peter Jego reports.
Sylvester Namiwa, the executive director for the Center for Democracy and Economic Development Initiative, says President Chakwera must immediately withdraw new government regulations for preventing the spread of coronavirus because he himself violated them when he attended the funeral ceremony where there were thousands of people in attendance and where there was no social distancing and many people were not even wearing face masks. Malawi government regulations prohibit more than 50 people attending a funeral ceremony, and it imposes a fine of 10,000 Malawi kwacha, about $13, to anyone not wearing a face mask in public.
Opposition supporters protesting against President Alassane Ouattara's decision to run for a third term in office have encountered tear gas fired by police. The demonstrators defied a ban on protests by erecting barricades and burning tires in the commercial capital Abidjan and elsewhere. A communal dispute between two villages in the Gambia has left scores wounded and several compounds set on fire. Omar Wali reports from Banjul.
The clash took place in Central River region, some 300 kilometers away from the capital, Banjul. The incident occurred when a donkey from one of the rival communities entered into a farmland belonging to others, leading to confrontation. Communal disputes are common in the area, especially among the farming community. The exact number of people affected is unknown. However, police have deployed security teams to the area to contain the situation. A police spokesperson told local media that the matter is under investigation.
And we reported yesterday on Liberia's vice president and former first lady Jewel Taylor being flown to Ghana to seek treatment. Jonathan Pelele in Monrovia gives us an update.
Health Minister Wilhelmina Jala says vice president Jewel Taylor had tested positive for COVID-19 on August 10 before flying to Ghana the next day. The minister's communication revealing these details is circulating on social media and published in local dailies here. The letter says the vice president was granted permission to travel on her doctor's advice, but how the letter ended up in the public domain has become a topical issue in the media. The relation between Vice President Tillor and President George Weah has not been so cordial.
Paul Bajibinga reminding us why Focus on Africa is such an institution around the continent.
Focus on Africa at 60.
We're celebrating Focus on Africa's 60th birthday all week in style and in rhythm and in time. Today we're looking back at the 1990s. This is Set by Youssou N'Dour. A decade of light and shade, with greater freedoms in some parts and the full horror of genocide in Rwanda, a transcontinental war emanating from then Zaire, and AIDS is a specter in many countries. But Eritreans vote for independence from Ethiopia, and there's huge joy when apartheid ends. Namibia is free, and Nelson Mandela is released on the 11th of February 1990, just in time for the last edition of Focus. And one of the key moments is the fall of the Ethiopian leader Mengistu Haile Mariam in 1991, as reported by Peter Biles.
It looks as though part of the presidential palace compound is now on fire. There are enormous flames rising into the sky from behind the trees of the perimeter wall. It's just half a mile away from here. Large, thick, black clouds of smoke are rising into the sky. We can't see who is doing the firing, but this constant tank fire has been going on now for some 10 minutes. The windows of my hotel room are shaking with the shocks of the explosions.
And that's Peter Biles, and I bet you he was reporting from the Gion Hotel there. I, in the meantime, was reporting for Focus as Nelson Mandela was sworn in as South Africa's first democratically elected president on May the 10th, 1994.
I was standing behind them because I'd walked out as they went out to face the press. And as Nelson Mandela turned around to go back inside, I put my hand out and he shook it and he said, "Oh, how very nice to see you again. Where have you been?" And for me, it testifies to the fact that this man has this wonderful personal touch, and everyone who meets him and everyone who just shakes his hand feels that he treats you like you're so special. So for me, it was a very special moment, because I'm going to boast from now on that I'm the first South African citizen, not politician or member of parliament, who shook the president's hand.
And I still boast that today, and nobody can prove me wrong. Now, we've been hearing from some of the people who for years reported for Focus. This is Anna Borzello, looking back on her time reporting from Uganda from 1995 to 2001.
I think about Northern Uganda a lot, and particularly about my time in Gulu during the conflict, and how you could hear the noise sometimes on the outskirts of town of the fighting, or you'd wake up in the morning and discover that 100 children had been abducted by rebels overnight.
Now, the LRA often threaten that they will come and take revenge raids on children that escape and return home. When you have the LRA coming back to Uganda as they are at the moment, do the children become frightened? Do they return to the centre because they're scared that they're going to be attacked?
Yes, quite a number right now, as I speak, some already in the centre also, who are scared of if they got the second time, maybe they will be killed.
Ugandans were really, really open into speaking into my tape recorder and would be really generous with their information and their personal experiences. I felt that I had an education in life, and I cannot thank Uganda enough. It was the most amazing experience. It was really difficult to get information out of the north. There were no mobile phones, so you had to rely on the telephone lines. And at the time, there was just 4 phone lines, I think, and they were in Gulu post office. And in the post office, there was this man called Valentino, who I really adored. He was a fantastic, moral, upright man. And he presided over these 4 women who would put little plugs and wires into what looked like a 1940s telephone board. And you had to queue up outside. And when it was your turn, he was scrupulously fair, Valentino. He'd make the phone call for you and the women would move all the little levers and plugs around. And then you'd get through to Focus on a bad line and you'd file your story. And it was not easy. And I noticed that Valentino used to watch them to make sure that they weren't eavesdropping on phone conversations. And I just loved going to that post office. In the 1990s, Focus on Africa was huge. And without any doubt, being the Focus reporter made an absolutely massive difference to the way people reacted to me. For example, when I was in northern Uganda in Gulu, when Focus on Africa came on the air, you'd actually hear the radio all the way up the street. People would tune in and I could hear my voice coming out. So people would come up afterwards and they'd say, yes, you did a good job, or no, that wasn't good. Or sometimes everyone would tell me it was bad, both the military and the civilians. Or sometimes they'd both say it was good. I think a good example of how important Focus was, there was a celebration at Kololo Airstrip in central Kampala, and there were loads of presidents there.
It was the president of Kenya, President Moi, the president of Burundi, Buyoya, Benjamin Mkapa from Tanzania. President Gaddafi appears to have persuaded President Bashir of Sudan to come to Uganda for President Museveni's inauguration, and that is extremely significant. The two countries broke off diplomatic relations in 1995. They've been trading insults ever since and accusing each other of supporting rebel groups hostile to their respective governments. There is absolutely no love lost between them at all.
And the Ugandans have brought this comedian, an impersonator, to come up and stand and perform in front of the crowds and in front of the presidents there. And he got up and he did impersonations of three people. He impersonated Nelson Mandela, he impersonated President Museveni of Uganda, and he impersonated me. I was so thrilled. It was so exciting. So I think that shows that Focus on Africa really mattered, that we were a voice that was heard and that counted. I think people trusted Focus on Africa. They really did. They felt that the BBC was giving them information that they might not be able to get elsewhere at that time. I felt that I was providing something that was of genuine use, and that really meant a lot to me. Perhaps one reason why we got so engaged was that we didn't get very much money. I don't think anyone realised quite how little money we got, and we got very little support logistically. In the end, I had to just go everywhere on a bus. So if I was going to a war zone on a bus that was frequently ambushed, and although that's obviously really risky, at the same time, it did mean that I felt that I was sharing experiences with people, and I think that brought me closer to the story. You do have a different angle on the story, perhaps, than if you were just sort of driving by in a nice Pajero with your own chauffeur.
And that's Anna Borzello. And the comedian who impersonated Anna and the other presidents was Ben Piri from Zambia. Imagine going to a war zone on a bus. Only on Focus on Africa. Bolaji Olatunde from Abuja tweeted, "My life would have been a little less fun if I hadn't had Focus on Africa in it. Robin White sits comfortably among my five top interviewers of all time. The mischief in his voice always came across over the radio. African leaders from long ago and even today won't talk to their local press. They're keener to speak to white journalists of the foreign media or African employees of the same. Robin White was one of those. He treated them with the amused condescension they so richly deserved. I hope he's doing well wherever he is." Our top story today on Focus: the High Court in Malawi has ruled that the police service must pay compensation to 18 women and girls who were raped and sexually assaulted by police officers in October last year. Tadala Chimkwezule is the president of the Women Lawyers Association of Malawi, who brought the case.
This case is quite a landmark because it's not every day that you have such a case where the police are held accountable. And we've already had colleagues in different countries, in Nigeria, in South Africa, asking us about this case. So the effect of this case will not only be in Malawi.
Coming up after the news, tentative celebrations for the people who live in the Ebo Forest of Cameroon as the government rescinds a previous decision to allow industrial logging there. Plus, of course, we'll have a full bulletin of sports news with Nishat Lada.
BBC News with Debbie Russ. The United States says Israel and the United Arab Emirates have signed a peace treaty that will open the way to normal diplomatic relations between the two. As part of the US-mediated deal, Israel will temporarily suspend plans to annex more Palestinian land. The Palestinians have reacted negatively to the agreement. The Lebanese government has asked the FBI to join the investigation into last week's devastating explosion in Beirut. US officials say agents will arrive in the country soon. A two-week state of emergency has meanwhile been approved by the Lebanese parliament. Activists fear it will be used to limit free speech and stop anti-government demonstrations. Protests against the disputed election victory of President Lukashenko of Belarus have spread to some state-run factories. The workers are also protesting against the authorities' violent reaction to widespread demonstrations against the election result. Turkey has warned it will exact a heavy price from those attacking a controversial oil exploration ship it sent to the eastern Mediterranean. Without giving any details, President Erdogan hinted such a confrontation had already taken place. The ship is carrying out its work in disputed waters. Police in Ivory Coast have used tear gas against opposition protesters, angry at President Ouattara's decision to run for a third term in office. Demonstrators have been building barricades and burning tyres in Abidjan and other cities across the country. Reports from Yemen say Houthi rebels have killed dozens of Ethiopian migrants and forced thousands of others into Saudi Arabia. The migrants said the Houthis claimed they were infected with coronavirus. Scientists say climate change may have been one of the main causes that led to the extinction of the Siberian woolly rhino. Previously, it was thought human hunting was to blame, but new research indicates humans and the rhinos coexisted for more than 10,000 years. BBC News.
Welcome back to Focus on Africa. I am Audrey Brown, and now for some good news from the Banin community in Cameroon, where the government has rescinded its decision to allow industrial logging in Ebo Forest, one of the least exploited rainforests in Central Africa and home to rare gorillas, chimpanzees and giant frogs. The decision initially made last month would have allowed the extraction of timber in vast swathes of the forest, which worried local communities who rely on the forest for survival and the sense of their identity. Chief Victor Yetina is a leader of the Banin people, who are the original inhabitants of the forest.
We certainly did not win a trophy, but we were restoring our rights because this Ebo Forest belonged to our community in a large part of it. The Ebo Forest was divided into forest management units. There was a decree of the Prime Minister saying that was going into government ownership, private ownership. And the other one, the procedure was not at its end. So what the government say is that he's withdrawing the decree of the Prime Minister, putting our land into his private ownership. And the other part of the forest, the procedure was going on. So they just put it on hold.
So if I'm to understand correctly, it's a permanent decision that they will not be logging in your part of the forest. And in the other part, they are still considering whether it will go into private ownership or not.
You get it right.
Both decisions affect you, right? Both the first one to rescind the logging, the decision to log, and the second one about the private ownership.
Yes, both affect us. Because when you go through our laws, once your land is in the government private ownership, it means you have no rights anymore into that land. So it's affected us. This is why since March this year, we're starting asking the government to hold this decision. And we are happy that the head of state have taken this decision.
Tell us about your forest. I hear birds chirping in the background there. Tell me a little bit about what is around you, what it's like living there.
Yeah, it's a very beautiful place. It's just unfortunate that we are going through, you know, this COVID moment. I invite all those out of this country to come and visit our land. The littoral region, we have a landscape of mountain with the gorillas, elephant, forest elephant, we have a chimpanzee, whatever you want.
And describe to me that bird that I can hear there that is being so loud.
We have so many birds. The names, it's Banin, our language. We were forced to leave our villages. In that forest, there are more than 40 villages that people were forced to leave early in the 60s due to violence for this independence. And the government promised to bring the people back 6 months later. But today, going to 60 years, nothing has been done. And where you go there, you have what you call an ocean of forest. So people want to go and benefit from that by doing this logging business. We as Banin people, I don't think we can benefit from such a business. But for our community, it will be something that we'll manage for the benefits of our community and the whole country, even the whole world. Because if they can fund what is funded at the time, it's because our parents, our ancestors keep these rich forests.
Tell me this. I really want to know what that bird looks like, the one that is, I can hear it so clearly.
It's a small size bird, a small size. What do you call it in French? I don't know the name in English, but we call it tourette.
Is it just gray? Is it brown? Is it black? Is it white?
It's brown color.
Okay.
Brown and gray. You see this brown and gray color?
I see.
And they are used to us that they don't even fear. They come close. When they see you eating, they come close. You just push the food and they take it.
Right. What does the forest mean for you and the communities that live in it?
This forest is our world identity. We as Banin people have always lived there. Our ancestors are buried there. Our sacred places are there. And in our culture, no initiation can be taken into Banin culture, can be only be done there. So as you can see, this is our identity. So we used to tell people it's not a matter of forest, it's not a matter of land, but it's a matter of identity.
Chief Victor Yetina, speaking from Cameroon.
Focus on Africa at 60.
Back to our 60th birthday celebrations now. And over the years, people have come and gone, including the many voices who've presented the stories. And here is one of them.
My name's Akwe Amosu. I joined Focus on Africa late in 1989. It was full of people that I revered. There might be a deep, intense argument about a choice we'd made at the daily meeting. But it felt like we were a band of brothers making the best thing we could make every day. And I know, because there was a sack of fan mail every week that those of us who did a selection of readers' letters had to sort through, that the listeners really appreciated the work that was being done.
Finally, a listener in Ghana is incensed by a letter we read out last week criticising our colleague Elizabeth Ohene for not having enough respect for African leaders.
Utter rubbish. Do African leaders have enough respect for themselves or for their people? If they did, they would not be such expert looters of their nation's coffers. Elizabeth Ohene, just go on grilling them. They don't deserve your respect.
When I got to Focus, it was presented by Chris Bickerton and KB Mensah. They were both extraordinarily good presenters and were much loved by the audience.
This is Chris Bickerton in London. Over the next half hour, we'll be bringing you news and comment from around the continent. Today's top African stories: a convoy of lorries transporting weapons and ammunition for a warlord opposed to the transitional government in Somalia has reached the capital, Mogadishu. Police in Malawi's capital, Lilongwe, have been deployed to force workers to restore water supplies after they cut them as part of strike action.
Chris Bickerton was an extraordinary person. I've really never worked with someone who had such humility and at the same time such extraordinary knowledge and information. He wore that knowledge very lightly and was gentle with people, almost never showed even any irritation.
BBC World Service at 18:30, Greenwich Mean Time. This is Kwabena Mensah with Focus on Africa. More deaths in Senegal's Casamance region. Togolese police under fire after yesterday's shooting incidents.
KB was also a brilliant colleague, incisive, a razor-sharp mind who did know inside out every story we were dealing with. He read voraciously. He was steeped in African history and politics. And reasonably enough, we were on a continental news program that 18 million people were listening to. He didn't suffer fools gladly. He didn't want to see people take that audience for granted.
Following reports that Rwanda's government forces had effectively defeated the rebel Patriotic Front,
the rebels have moved to show that they're still in the game, with a surprise attack on the border post of Gatuna on the frontier between Uganda and Rwanda.
I know that I felt very heavily the responsibility of the role. I think being on air, even in front of a small number of people, can make you feel very uneasy if you're not on top of your facts. On the other hand, I think it would be true to say, and this could be said to be a real problem for a programme like Focus on Africa, or a broadcaster like the World Service, that you have this enormous reach and power. You're not sitting on the ground broadcasting something critical about the president. You're sitting in London doing it. And so there could be a sense, I think, of irresponsibility or overconfidence on the part of the program's producers, because it made you invulnerable. You could say what you wanted to say. On the other hand, I think there'd be a lot of people who'd say, well, thank goodness for that, because without that, Focus would not have had the ability to rupture some of the false narratives that were circulated by people in power across the continent. And I feel that we knew that we were there for the right reason, doing the right work.
And that's Focus presenter and deputy editor from the past, Akwe Amusu, another influential figure in my life, as one of those responsible for bringing me to Focus on Africa. And now from a presenter and deputy editor to the listeners, it's time to hear about your relationship with Focus.
So my name is Eddie Guimeng. I'm from Liberia, West Africa. I'm 25 years old. I first started listening to Focus on Africa 2003. That time I was much younger, 9 or 10. So I used to hear the jingles for Focus on Africa. And then my older brothers and my family will be listening because we used to get the news about the war in my country at that time. So after many years, when I graduated from high school 2012, one day I tuned my radio to 103.1, which is the frequency for BBC in Liberia. And then there was a program called BBC Outlook. So when I listened to Outlook, their stories were very inspiring. And then I continued to listen up to 3 o'clock, and then boom, you know. And I was like, wow, this is the program I remember when I was a boy during the war. I used to listen to, my family used to sit around the radio and listen to. So from that day on, I continued to listen to BBC Focus on Africa. Focus on Africa is the only independent news. So Focus on Africa is important to us. You know, I learned a lot from BBC because of their interviews with people from around the world. One of the things I do want to recommend to BBC is that sometimes I think it will be better you carry innovative story about young people in Africa rather than always talking about the negative things to politicians do. Because year in, year out, it is clear that they will not change. Politicians in Africa are very bad. They don't have no remorse. But then there are a lot of young people or entrepreneurs who are producing and doing a lot of great things that are changing our lives. So I think I would recommend to Focus on Africa sometimes bring those stories as headlines and rather than always focusing on politics.
Thank you so much, Eddie from Liberia. And now, we don't focus on politics only, as you know. Nisha Dlada is here with sports.
I sure am. Thank you, Audrey. Let's start with football. The European Champions League quarterfinals continue tonight, and Ghana fans will be hoping that Thomas Partey is past fit to play for Atletico Madrid when they face RB Leipzig. Waiting in the semi-finals for the winners will be Paris Saint-Germain, who secured a late victory on Wednesday to beat Atalanta 2-1. PSG's Brazilian star Neymar was in terrific form with a hand in both goals, but it was Cameroon's Eric Maxim Choupo-Moting who came off the bench to score a famous winner.
I was confident in myself, I was confident in the team. I think the whole team never lost hope. Just like the coach had said, we've prepared well in the last 2 or 3 months. I personally gave it my all and I'm very, very happy. The emotion is there. It's hard to describe everything. It's a special story and I'm very, very happy, of course. When I came on, I told myself, no, we can't go back home to Paris with this exceptional team. I think Neymar had an exceptional game with incredible actions, but unfortunately, he didn't score a goal. He could have scored two or three goals. And so when I came on, I told myself, anything is possible in life.
In other football news, Ghanaian defender Mohamed Salisu has moved to Southampton from Spanish La Liga side Real Valladolid. The fee is reported to be just over $14 million. In athletics, some of Africa's top track and field stars will be back competing on Friday at the Monaco Diamond League meeting. Strict health protocols are being observed, including the testing of athletes before travelling and as soon as they arrived in Monaco. Amongst those taking part will be Kenya's Timothy Cheruiyot, the world 1500 metres champion. He says he can't wait to be back.
It's a long time because this pandemic, COVID-19. So we accept all the challenges and we are focused on training. Even the last few months there was no races, but I'm happy now because I'm focusing on Monaco. My expectation in Monaco, I need to run to lower my BP and to run a good time. When I'm competing, I feel happy because that's my talent and my, you know, half worldwide fan, so he expected me to run well in Monaco. I miss competing so sana.
Kenya's Timothy Cheruiyot. Also running in Monaco will be Uganda's Joshua Cheptegei, who's aiming to break the world record for the 5,000 metres it stood for 16 years. There's more on that on the BBC Sport Africa website. In basketball's NBA, Milwaukee Bucks forward Giannis Antetokounmpo, who's of Nigerian heritage, has been handed a one-game suspension for headbutting Washington Wizards center Mo Wagner. The Bucks have already clinched top seed in the Eastern Conference, but Giannis admits he's not proud of what he did.
Terrible action. You know, if I could go back, turn back the time and go back to that play, you know, I wouldn't do it. But at the end of the day, you know, we're all human, we all make mistakes. I think I've done a great job, you know, all year, my career. Keep my composure and focus on the game. But, you know, at the end of the day, as I say, we're human, we make mistakes. But at the end of the day, learn from it, keep playing good basketball and keep moving forward.
And some tennis news, Audrey. Serena Williams and her big sister Venus are on court in Kentucky for yet another contest between the two. They're playing for a place in the quarterfinals of the women's tour event. This is the first to be held in the United States since lockdown. I can tell you, Venus has taken the first set 6-3. It's already been a good tournament for Tunisia's Ange Jabeur. She's into the last eight, where she will play American teenager Coco Gauff on Friday. That's all the sport, Audrey.
Something to look forward to tomorrow. Thank you very much, Nishat. Now, our letter this week is from the Somali journalist Ismail Enashe, who is musing on Italy's relationship with the Horn of Africa.
Earlier this month, Rome City Council voted to name a future metro station in the Italian capital in honour of Giorgio Marincola, an Italian Somali who was a member of the Italian resistance. He was killed at the age of 21 by withdrawing Nazi troops who opened fire at a checkpoint on 4th May 1945, 2 days after Germany had officially surrendered in Italy at the end of World War II. The station, which is currently under construction, was going to be called Amba Aradam Ipionio, a reference to an Italian campaign in Ethiopia in 1936 when fascist forces brutally unleashed chemical weapons and committed war crimes at the infamous Battle of Amba Aradam. The name change came after a campaign was launched in June in the wake of Black Lives Matter protest around the world, started by journalist Massimiliano Coccia. He was supported by BLM activists, other journalists, and Italian Somali writer Ijabo Shego, and Marincola's nephew, the author Anta Marincola. They first placed a banner at the metro site stating that no station should be named after oppression and pushed for Marincola's short but remarkable life to be remembered. He is known as the Partigiano Nero, or Black Partisan, and was an active member of the resistance. In 1953, he was posthumously awarded Italy's highest military honour in recognition of his efforts and the ultimate sacrifice he made. Maringola was born in 1923 in Mahadei, a town on the Shebele River north of Mogadishu, in what was then known as Italian Somaliland. His mother, Ashkero Hassan, was Somali, and his father was an Italian military officer called Giuseppe Maringola. At the time, few Italian colonialists acknowledged children born of their unions with Somalis, but Giuseppe Maringola bucked the trend and later brought his son and daughter Isabella to Italy to be raised by his family. Giorgio Maringola was gifted, excelling at school in Rome, and went on to enroll as a medical student. During his studies, he came to be inspired by anti-fascist ideology. He decided to enlist in the resistance in 1943. At the time, his own country was still under Italian rule. He proved a brave fighter, was parachuted into enemy territory, and was wounded. At one time, he was captured by the SAS, who wanted him to speak against the partisans on their radio station. On air, he reportedly defied them, saying, "Homeland means freedom and justice for the peoples of the world. This is why I fight the oppressors." The broadcast was interrupted and sounds of beating could be heard. But this story is about more than just the renaming of a metro stop after Maringola. It's about putting the spotlight on Italy's colonial history. Activists want the authorities in Rome to go further and begin a process of decolonizing the city. Yet, to bring about true change, there needs to be an awareness about the past. In the years I have spent reporting from the country, I'm always struck at how little most Italians seem to know about their colonial history. Last month, Somalia celebrated its 60th anniversary of independence. Reshaped by 30 years of conflict, memories of colonial times have all been lost, except in the kitchen, where staples of Somali cuisine are sugo sugar, a sauce eaten with pasto or pasta. But for this Somali bolognese, we use goat, lamb and camel meat, tomatoes mixed with heady spices. My Italian friends have eaten it with curiosity and some raised eyebrows. Somalis too have also left their own imprint in Italy, not just through the Maringola siblings, but in the literature, film and sports. Christina Alifara is a well-known novelist. Amin Noor is a popular actor. Zarha Bani represented Italy as a javelin thrower. And Omar Degan is a respected architect. And today, Somalis constitute some of Italy's oldest and newest migrants. The naming of a station after Maringola is an important move for all of them, and a timely reminder for all Italians of the long ties between Italy and Somalia.
You live and learn. That's what Focus does best. Somali journalist Ishmael Einashe with our weekly letter. To end this program, let's hear from Bodhisattva, DJ and producer of electronic dance music for the last 20 years or so. He's worked with Grammy Award winners, including Umo Sangare, and collaborated with the likes of Davido and DJ Arafat. He's from the Central African Republic, and DJ Edu asked Bodhisattva what kind of music he listened to when he was growing up.
I was born in Bangui, the capital city of Central African Republic, but I grew up in the eastern part of the country, in Bria, in a little city called Bria. At the time, it was only 50,000 people living in that city, and that's where I grew up. So I was bathed with all these traditional banda sounds and all these rhythms. And so for me, encounter with music was something that really, really was from an early stage of my life. And also being, you know, fruit of mix, my father being black, my mother white, me coming out white, There was a thing where I was the only white kid in the area for quite a long time, but I was never really made felt different than my childhood friends, because, you know, I speak perfectly the languages, a couple of our, you know, national languages, etc. So anyway, I just never really felt different.
Why did you pick dance when there were so many other genres you could complement your music?
Well, I was introduced, so as I said, my eldest brothers were listening to acid house, new beat, you know, that old era. So for me, I really liked these sounds and I was finding them extremely interesting. And there was already a syncopation within this music that I was like, well, if it's made in Europe, but these are sounds that I know in the village, the same sort of like rhythm is... How is that working? So it was really triggering my interest. And then my uncle, my father's youngest brother, brought from London. It was a CD of this guy called Kevin Yost, Deep House Finest, in my personal opinion. It blew my mind. You know, it's like a movie when you feel like when something, an explosion happens in your brain and you don't know how to explain it, but a revolution happened. It started growing and evolving in my brain. I wanted to start making fusions because I realized that sound was the actual perfect sound to mix all and put together all these influences that I had in me. The rest is history, pretty much.
I've been lucky enough to come to one of the clubs that you've been DJing at, and I've seen the impact of your music. It just uplifts people in a different way. It just makes them want to move, want to dance, and you're not one to shy away from busting some moves as well when you DJ. You proper,
you know,
because I was there and they were like, body sad, but body sad, but so like people in the crowd, they, you know, just screaming your name.
Body Sadva, beatmaker, Davido featuring Arafat.
You've also worked with Davido, and with me, what was interesting with that joint is you didn't sacrifice your signature sound to suit the Afrobeat kind of vibe. You still went ancestral on him
and
still sounded fresh.
Thank you, brother. There's always been mutual respect between us whenever we see each other. He was like, yo, man, this guy gave me my first hit for the Francophone world. Huh? You know this guy? Bodhisattva, right? It was cool. But Arafat and him together nailed the joint.
Bodhisattva, DJ and producer from the Central African Republic. You can hear a longer version of that conversation at bbcworldservice.com/thisisafrica. With a name like Bodhisattva, I wonder if he's a Buddhist or a fan of Steely Dan's music. Go and look it up. You'll know, you'll see what I mean. Thank you so much for joining us for this edition of Focus on Africa. We will be back with another one at 19 GMT.